Don is married to Alice, and they've been married for 59 years. They have 4 children, one of whom is living with the Lord. And they have 10 grandchildren. Alice is here, and Don's son, Don, is here. Alice and Don, where are you seated? Back there? Wait, welcome. When I was doing doctoral residency here in Dallas, for the year and a half that I was here, Dr. Geiger was my pastor. And he was also the pastor of our pastor, Joe Allen, when Joe was a student here for the years that he was here. And so there are a lot of ties, both personal and as well as professional. But Don Geiger has been a model to so many of us, a faithful pastor, a mentor, a friend, an encourager. And it's a privilege, Pastor Geiger, to have you back. Would you join me in welcoming Pastor Don Geiger?
One small clarification. All of our children are walking with the Lord. One of them happens to be in heaven walking with the Lord. I just wanted to make that clear. This Heritage Chapel this morning is about roots, exploring our Dallas Seminary roots. I was invited to speak here this morning because on the one hand, I did know and learned under Dr. Chafer, and on the other hand, during that year, I was asked to write a first-person narrative of his life and ministry to be presented at the banquet that following spring. So I had the privilege of going to his home and listening to him tell his life story, frantically scrawling his words long before the days of tape recorders. We did have electricity, but no air conditioning. Listening to Dr. Chafer reminisce and sitting under his teaching, I gained a terrific appreciation for the rich heritage that is ours, for the determination, perseverance, sacrifice by Dr. Chafer and others that has made possible the blessings that we enjoy here at the seminary. We have much to learn from our founder. So this morning I will touch on a few significant highlights of his story, as he told me, reflect on the impact on his ministry on all of our lives, and then as one who has been where you are and where you aspire to go, make a few modest suggestions that I hope will help you maximize your time at Dallas Seminary. Every chapel talk, no matter what it's about, needs a text, of course. Hebrews 10:32, remember the earlier days. Another one straight from God through Isaiah 46:8. Remember this, fix it in mind. Take it to heart, you millennials. Oh, sorry, my Hebrew's a little rusty. Take it to heart, you rebels. Oh, same thing. Remember the former days, the things of long ago. Moses, in those all-important last words before he died and went to heaven, to Israel. 13 times in Deuteronomy, Moses said, remember, remember, remember well how the Lord led you all the way. Remember and never forget. David, Psalm 143, I remember the days of long ago. I meditate on all your works. Consider all that you have done. So this morning, let's remember, meditate, and consider a little of what God has done at Dallas Seminary through Dr. Chafer, to whom we all owe so much, and who can continue to touch and teach us all. Born to godly parents, his father a pastor, Lewis Berry Chafer trusted Christ at age 6. His father was a pastor, and when Lewis was 11, the father died of tuberculosis. And at that time, Lewis began to help the family, which had fallen on hard times, in any way he could, just as an 11-year-old After school, he'd work on a farm. He sold books and even knives door to door, whatever it took to support the family. Dr. Chafer told me how when he was 13, a dying evangelist named Scott came to town preaching the message of grace, and he too was dying of tuberculosis. It was as though I was in the room alone with him. He spoke straight to me. I heard the message of grace as never before. It was as if Scott threw me a flaming torch, the torch of the grace of God, and I've been carrying it ever since. And that is Dr. Chafer's life in one sentence. And by the way, never underestimate the power of your words in the lives of the children and the kids to whom you minister. They may be texting and tweeting and eagerly waiting to hear those blessed words now in conclusion. But they're also listening and hearing more than you may think. What you say just may change their lives as Scott changed Chafer's. Scott would die of tuberculosis shortly thereafter. Fast forwarding now to early marriage, Chafer himself would be diagnosed with tuberculosis. The doctor told him, "Lewis, there's nothing I can do about it. I'm sorry." Dr. Chafer said, "I prayed, all right, Lord, you win, I'll preach." Shortly after that crisis, Lewis preached his first evangelistic series. He said, "I was scared to death, but the Lord honored our obedience, and 30 people were saved during those meetings." Wow. Illustrating the importance of finding the courage to do something that scares you to death. Considerably later in his life, Chafer once again would find the courage to do something that scared him to death, and as a result, you and I are able to sit here today and enjoy the blessings of Dallas Seminary. Well, afterward, Chafer and his wife returned to the doctor, who found only negative scar tissue. He said the doctor didn't understand it, but we knew. Over the years, he would tell concerned doctors that those dark spots on his lung were simply God's reminder to him and not to worry about them. Like his family, Chafer was musically gifted. Played the piano, the cornet, he sang second tenor. He entered the Oberlin College Conservatory of Music, where he met and married Lorraine Chase, who herself was an accomplished pianist and organist. He said they courted over Beethoven, Bach, and Brahms, and Mendelssohn. They became an evangelistic musical team, ministering with some of the leading evangelists and Bible teachers of the day, including Dwight L. Moody, F.B. Meyer, W.H. Griffith Thomas, C.I. Schofield. These and other men, especially Schofield, were influential in shaping his theology and, indirectly, ours. Dr. Chafer related another incident that shaped his life. He had preached an evangelistic series for Dr. Schofield, who was then pastor of the First Congregational Church here in Dallas. It's now Schofield Memorial Church. At the conclusion of the meetings, Dr. Schofield called him into his study and to tell him that while he was not a gifted evangelist, he had the makings of a good Bible teacher. He said, "You must become a man of one book. You must commit yourself all out to the study and mastery of it." And then Chafer said he made me kneel in his chair where he'd been sitting. He said he spread his great hulk over me and prayed such a prayer as I'll never forget, committing me to the Lord and to a lifetime study of one book. Smiling, Dr. Chafer told me, he said, sometime later, Schofield called him and said, "Chafer, don't try to start that school, it'll kill you." Chafer said, "It just made me all the more determined to do it." It takes many words adequately to describe our founder. Determined, persevering, sometimes stubborn, are three of them. I caught a glimpse of that while I was in his home. He had showed me a saber and unsheathed it while he was telling its story. And in trying to return the saber to the sheath, the tip was wobbling a little bit. After all, Chafer was 80 and had had a heart attack and a stroke. So I reached out just to guide the tip into the sheath. "Son, I can do this." And he did. Chafer's passion to establish a seminary was born of numerous encounters in those early years with young pastors and seminary students who complained that their seminary experience did not give them adequate theological or biblical training. And several of them kept urging him to take them on and train them. And over many years, that passion matured into plans increasingly shared by other influential people, including Dr. Will Anderson, pastor of First Presbyterian here in Dallas. It was his influence that led them to choose Dallas over Denver, Seattle, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, or even Wheaton. Another influential person was Dr. W.H. Griffith Thomas, well-known and respected Anglican scholar and theologian who had agreed to become the theology professor. And they hoped and expected that his influence, he would be a strong drawing card for potential students. It was his influence that led them to name this school Evangelical Theological College. Did you know that was their first name? They chose college over seminary following British terminology. Dr. Thomas never taught at ETC. He died in June of 24, just months before the school opened. So Dr. Chafer would become the resident theologian. By now, he has written 7 significant books, all of which are readily available. First, Satan in 1909, followed by True Evangelism, The Kingdom and History and Prophecy, Salvation, He That Is Spiritual, Grace, and Major Bible Themes. Furthermore, along with Dr. Schofield and Dr. William Pettengill, Chafer had helped found the Philadelphia School of the Bible, where my father would be an early graduate. It became Philadelphia College of Bible. It is now Cairns University. Chafer also had briefly succeeded Dr. Schofield both as pastor of First Congregational Church here and also as the director of the Central America Mission, which Dr. Schofield also helped establish. It is now Camino Global, as you may know. By now, Chafer is well known and widely in demand as an outstanding Bible teacher. So Dr. Chafer brought a rich and varied ministry background to the challenge of founding what is now Dallas Theological Seminary. Even so, thrust into the role of professor of theology, Dr. Chafer described his intense and sometimes frantic study. He said he devoured theologians Hodge, Strong, Calvin, Shedd, and others. He said it was a battle those first 2 years just to stay ahead. But stay ahead, he did. Not having a theology text fully to his liking, one that would combine moderate Calvinistic theology with the Bible Conference Brethren emphasis on dispensational premillenarianism. Hey, I can't say that word always, but doctor, I do believe it. By the way, when you're reading scripture and you haven't had time to check the pronunciation of some difficult, obscure word, what you do is just look up there and say the word with confidence and move on. And everybody will say, "Oh, that's how you pronounce that word." So Dr. Chafer prepared 4 substantial booklets of questions. I have one in my hand. 1 booklet for each year of study. Thousands of questions in all, covering all the major and most of the minor aspects of theology. He would base his lectures on those questions, and he expected his students to master the material between each class. He wrote this in the introduction of each book. Sound advice for us all. He said, too much emphasis cannot be placed on the importance of mastering each lesson on the day it is given and upon the importance of constant reviewing until complete familiarity is secured. Books 1 and 2 for the first 2 years covered the basic areas of theology. Book 3 was a doctrinal review and summary, 2,800 questions just in Book 3, covering 180 subjects. Here's one way you would be examined in your studies. Let's assume there were 30 students in your class. That was Chafer's idea of an ideal size. When 30 subjects had been covered, these subjects would be listed on 30 slips of paper. You would come to class, draw out one slip from the hat, and quote, be expected to write throughout the hour, setting forth that doctrine in a comprehensive and constructive manner. And of course, unless you wanted to play Russian roulette, you had to be prepared to do that with all 30. I have those booklets 1, 2, and 3. Talk about theological detail. For instance, 94 questions just on the subject of the divine decrees. I'm so thankful I got here 4 years after his theology was published. And that plan of study and testing with its 5,081 theology questions, plus another 1,000 or so in Book 4 on other subjects, was history. Dr. Walvoord, our second president, described Dr. Chafer in his prime. He was a forceful, energetic teacher, a fire breather at times. There was no sleeping in his class. What he said almost came from God. U.S. Army Chaplain Lieutenant Colonel Floyd Sheery. There was about Chafer a humility and a loveliness that made his every word a benediction. Chafer's teaching, however technical and detailed, was always intended to be life-changing and practical, as illustrated in these questions in Book 3. Question 2795, what has been your own experience relative to your spiritual life as a result of your study of doctrine? 2797, what effect has doctrinal study had upon your ideals of Christian service? Great questions for any course of study at Dallas Seminary. I asked Dr. Donald Campbell, for whom this building is named, our third president, who studied under Dr. Chafer for 5 years. I asked him to review this message for accuracy and relevance, and then add his comments. Here are his comments. Dr. Chafer was my inspiration. My life was forever marked by his classes in spiritual life, evangelism, and soteriology. He loved to teach about the finished work of Christ as redemption, reconciliation, and propitiation. And by the way, when I was in his study in his home, I noticed on his desk a plaque, God is propitious. Throughout their lives, money had almost always been in short supply. And the Chafers early learned the power of fervent prayer and total trust. The founding of the seminary was no different. For the most part, Dr. Chafer followed the examples of Hudson Taylor and George Mueller and did not solicit funds or allow others to do so, trusting God to supply in response to prayer. There are many stories of God's miraculous provision in those early years. There are also stories of faculty salaries not being paid on time and creditors applying pressure. On several occasions in those earliest years, the door stayed open only because Dr. Chafer resolutely, stubbornly refused to heed the recommendation of those close to him to close the seminary. Here is perhaps his favorite story, which he told with some emotion. It was the spring of 29. The school was 5 years old and deeply in debt. creditors were threatening to foreclose on the property, which by now included both Davidson and Stearns Halls. They desperately needed $10,000 to pay the most pressing bills. So Dr. Chafer called the school to prayer. Graduation was on Tuesday, May 7, and Dr. Chafer, his brother Roland, Dr. Harry Ironside, and Dr. Fred Lincoln, who were key people in this seminary, they decided that the money should be in by 9 o'clock the morning of Monday, May 6, or else Dr. Chafer at graduation the next day would announce that the school would not reopen. 2 weeks before graduation, Vice President Will Anderson had told Dr. Chafer that he had awakened at 5 that morning with a great burden to pray for the finances of the school. He went on to tell how he'd gotten up, gone to his study to pray for half an hour, then back to bed. Dr. Chafer told how he too had had the same experience at the same hour. Later they found that two of the students had had the same experience. But still the money didn't come in. So early that fateful Monday morning, Dr. Chafer prayed both that the money would be there by 9 o'clock and for the strengthening of their faith, it might come from someone who had never given to the school. At 8:30 Monday morning, Dr. Chafer reached the office, found his brother Roland and Ironside and Lincoln. He described them as a pretty beat bunch, dolefully sitting around, not saying anything. And then a registered letter was delivered to the office. It contained a United States government bond for $10,000, sent from the president of a bank in Alton, Illinois. There had been no contact with him except to answer a letter of inquiry. The accompanying letter told how the man had awakened just 2 weeks before at 5 in the morning, felt compelled to pray for the seminary and to send the money. And Dr. Campbell suggested that I go ahead and tell you the name of that banker was C.A. Caldwell, who was the maternal grandfather of Charles Caldwell Ryrie, who at that time would have been 4 years old. Dr. Chafer said he tossed the letter on the floor and says, "There it is, man." He said Dr. Ironside made a dive for it. The others were on the floor with him. He said we were all crying like babies. Would $10,000 get you on the floor crying like a baby, doctor? Some days. You know the feeling. Let this be a reminder to pray for the seminary, and especially for our president, who bears that burden 24/7. So when you awake at 5 in the morning with a burden to pray for the seminary, follow your good impulse, get up, and pray. Drawing on his lecture notes and the books he had written, in 1937, Dr. Chafer began writing what would become his 8-volume systematic theology, now edited and published as a 2-volume set. It would be a decade in the writing, all written longhand twice, he said, all written while leading the seminary, maintaining a full schedule of teaching theology and other subjects, such as how to lead singing, he did that too, and maintaining a conference ministry. He told how on one occasion he was ministering in Los Angeles, and between meetings he was writing the section on harmartiology, the doctrine of sin. He said he desperately needed to quote from Dr. Julius Mueller's 2-volume out of print, The Christian Doctrine of Sin. So he prayed about it. And then he took a walk up 6th Street and happened on a used bookstore. Got any theology books? Yeah, over there. Dr. Chafer says, I walked over, and there they were at eye level, pulled out about 2 inches from the other books, Julius Mueller's set. And so the work went on. Just out of curiosity in preparing this, I went to my theology and looked up that section and that quote. And sure enough, Dr. Chafer in class had referred to them as his miracle books. Here's another writing his theology story. Prof. Hendricks told this one in soteriology class so you know it's true. The Chafers were vacationing in Maine, and one rainy day, Dr. Chafer was writing on soteriology. Mrs. Chafer, in another room, kept hearing, "Amen, glory, hallelujah." Mrs. Chafer came in and says, "What's wrong, dear? What could possibly make a Presbyterian shout?" Dr. Chafer said, "Sit down, honey, and let me tell you what the Lord has done for you." He had listed with scripture references 33 things that happen the moment we place our trust in Jesus Christ the Savior. The riches of divine grace, he called them. It is a small treasure of biblical truth. It's a must-have little classic. You can look it up in his theology under soteriology, the riches of divine grace, or you can just Google the riches of divine grace, and it'll come up in two or three places. My first modest suggestion to you to maximize your student days is to find that treasure, the riches of divine grace, and ever so gradually take your time and work through them all, scripture reference by scripture reference. It will lift the clouds. It will enrich your spirit. From the beginning, Dr. Chafer began each school year with a week of chapel messages on the spiritual life and the message of grace. It was a spiritual feast. He reasoned that only spiritually minded students could truly understand the truth. So these messages set the tone for the year of study and basically followed the theme of his little classic, "He That Is Spiritual," which I heartily recommend. It will give you a feel for Chafer's heart and message of grace. It will serve as an example of clarity and simplicity and biblical accuracy, as well as strengthen you in your spiritual walk. And so my second modest suggestion is get a hold of "He That Is Spiritual" and make it as a lifelong treasure. Whether in chapel, in the classroom, or in his writings, the focus of his message was always the grace of God as revealed in Jesus Christ and our intimate relationship with him. He told us once that the seven most important words in the Bible were found in John 14, 20. "You in me, and I in you." He would tell us that you could find Jesus Christ on every page of the Bible. And for more on that, I heartily recommend Dr. Curavella's lead article in this year's April-June BibSec. His article is entitled "Christoconic Interpretation." He makes a strong case for Christ on every page. So thank you, Dr. Curavella. Dr. Chafer both advocated and modeled simplicity and clarity in ministry. I remember he would say, "Men," sorry ladies, this was decades before the Enlightenment. "Men, mist in the pulpit is fog in the pew." And it is. And humor. He told us the preacher's worst nightmare is to dream he is preaching and wake up and discover it's true. By the time classmate Dr. Tan Toussaint and I sat under his ministry, Chafer, by then 80, was frail in body, weakened by a heart attack and a stroke. He was still mentally sharp, spiritually vibrant, passionate about Jesus Christ and the grace of God, still enjoyed telling a good joke or hearing one. So Dr. Chafer's life was presented as a first-person dramatic narrative at the president's banquet that spring. We titled it, "Blessings All Mine," straight from the hymn we just sang. "Blessings All Mine, 10,000 beside." Graduate student Don Campbell then presented him with a check from the student body toward the cost of Chafer Chapel, which was then under construction. Dr. Chafer joyfully accepted the check, thanked everyone, then true to form, cracked a couple jokes. Dr. Chafer was a complex man, strong-minded, persevering, largely self-taught theologian, biblical scholar, stubborn at times. He was also kind, gentle, gracious, godly, humble, and optimistic. Optimistic sometimes to a fault. He believed that any of his students could do just about anything. In my time as a student, the rumor floated around that the newly crowned Queen of England, Elizabeth II, had called Dr. Chafer to ask him to recommend a man to become Dean of London's historic Westminster Abbey. Dr. Chafer's alleged reply, "Any of my men will do just fine." Here's how Dr. Chafer summarized his life. God ruined a good farmer and a fairly good musician to become a preacher and the most blessed man alive. Those early seminary days were life-changing, faith-stretching, foundation-laying days of sacrifice, challenge, achievement. But they are not the good old glory days. These are the good old days. Dr. Chafer was just the first of five presidents, each of them chosen and called by God, each making his unique contribution to giving Dallas Seminary the worldwide influence it wields today. So I encourage you, explore your heritage. Take advantage of the rich resource that is your faculty and administration. Read Dr. Hanna's definitive historical account entitled An Uncommon Union, Dallas Theological Seminary and American Evangelicalism. But most important, maximize your time at this great school. To that end, as one who has both been where you are and where you aspire to go, four more modest suggestions that I believe will help you maximize your time here. If, as I hope, you're already doing them, great. Just count this as an encouragement and an affirmation. Number one, get actively involved in your seminary days in a local church where you can serve and not just soak, where you can work and not as well as worship, give as well as take. Put down roots. Don't be picky. Volunteer to be a guard of the parking lot. And men, whatever else you do, volunteer to work in the nursery to learn firsthand all you can about that all-important ministry in church life. Get hands-on experience. Two, following Dr. Chafer's advice, truly master the material you're learning. Make it lifelong learning. Memorize supporting passages. Scripture that is memorized packs an exponentially multiplied punch, both in our own lives and in the lives of those to whom we minister. Make regular scripture memory a lifelong practice. Three, despite your overfull plate, make time regularly to read and reread the Bible in large chunks, chapters at a time, a book at a time, to get the broad overall picture as well as the details. Study the Bible macro as well as micro. Like Chafer, become a man or woman of the book. All scripture is profitable, but a good bit of it is also puzzling. And your professors are some of the world's greatest puzzle solvers. And they are eager to explain to you while you're still here on campus over a Coke or coffee, for instance, just why Elisha cursed those taunting teenagers and let the bears rough them up a bit. just for teasing him about being follically challenged? And when you find their answer, please email me. I've always wanted to know. Take full advantage of this rich resource, your faculty. As Moses counseled in his 13th and final remember, Deuteronomy 32, 7, remember, ask your elders, and they will explain it to you. Finally, don't you love to hear that word? Finally, keep a positive attitude. Dallas Seminary is a great school, but it's not perfect. It has never been perfect, nor will it ever be as long as you or I are part of it. But it is solid. It is strong. It is true to its roots. It is where God has you. It is where together we can learn to teach truth and love well. Now to him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God, our Savior, be glory and majesty and authority and power through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now, and forevermore. And all God's millennials and others said, Amen. Amen. God bless you.